Hi, welcome everybody. Today I'm going to talk about a very exciting subject. Because you've probably seen a couple of other sessions in similar directions as well. This has everything to do with artificial intelligence and machine learning and all kinds of exciting things here. I'd like to introduce you on a platform that is provided by Microsoft, which is called the Cognitive Services API. And before I get into the details of it, let me first describe what does cognitive mean. If you would look it up on the web, you'll get a description something like, cognition is the mental action or process of acquiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experience, and senses. And, well, if we think about it, I mean, I actually came on this subject because I have two daughters. The youngest one is 2, the oldest one is 4, and, well, I mean, they were at a certain stage, they were in the process of starting to talk, starting to recognize certain things. And if I saw that all happening, especially with my oldest one, and my youngest one is in the same process right now, and I thought it was very interesting that she would actually recognize different kind of things. And I thought, but yeah, how does that work? I mean, if we would, I would immediately think about like algorithms, like how would I do that in a on a computer? How would I recognize certain things? And, well, that is something that is, these days, it is quite possible. And specifically things like thought, experience, and senses. Well, these days, the senses, you can do that with, like, all kinds of sensors, IoT devices, stuff like that. Experience, that would be something in software, computer software, like machine learning. And a thought is basically something like AI, and that is something which is really exciting because that is getting on as we speak. I mean, AI is taking a big leap now. But getting back to my daughters, I'd like to show you a couple of examples here. And for everybody who's interested, here they are, but it's not the main thing of my talk. I noticed with one of the two, like, she would recognize a dog. And, I mean, this is a dog. But I thought it was most interesting. I mean, in Holland, the dogs, I'm from Holland, so the dogs, they say woof, woof, according to my daughter. So this was a woof, woof. But then we were doing something else, and there was, like, this other dog, and she would also recognize this as a woof, woof. And then we were back home, we were reading a book, and she started recognizing this as a woof woof as well. Well, if I would show her a picture of a cat, that would be a meow. That's what they do in Holland. But then again, I showed her another book, and it was the same. This was considered to be a dog as well. And what you see here is that even she has a little cuddle toy, this is a dog as well. And what you see here is all kinds of different shapes. Some of them are real, some of them are drawn. They all have ears and a tail and a nose or something. But anyway, she recognized this as all being dogs. And, well, I was actually wondering if I would need to write a computer algorithm to have these pictures analyzed in some form or shape. How would we determine whether it is a dog or a cat or something else? And so this is typically something which is one of your cognitive senses that we have and that we learn specifically when we are kids. But another thing here is, so enough about the kids and my kids in general and the dogs. Let's get back to some serious work. If I ask any of you which picture doesn't belong here, I mean, okay, we like all of it, but there is one particular one that doesn't belong here. It will take you like a snap second, like, okay, there is one that doesn't fit in here. But if you would need to write a computer program that would tell you which one doesn't belong here, that's got to be a tricky story, huh? Well, and this is actually one of the really cool things that come with the Microsoft Cognitive Services. But you'll see in a couple of minutes that the Cognitive Service is a really powerful platform. And it is actually built on top of machine learning and artificial intelligence. And do we have any machine learning experts here or people who have heard of it? Yeah, maybe I've seen a couple of talks here and there. Machine learning is basically, as you remember, the definition of cognition is experience. Machine learning is able to draw conclusions out of huge amounts of data. So the more data you have, the more experience, the better a prediction can be done based on machine learning algorithms. And AI, obviously, is on top of that because it will use the experience that comes with the machine learning, basically. And the cognitive services is like a collection of services. So it's not just one function. It's got like a whole set of things here. And one of the services here is the Vision API. I checked out a session this morning at the other side from the guys from Google. They were also talking about the Vision API from Google. I mean, all of the big guys, they have platforms like this. I mean, Facebook has something similar. Google obviously is working on it. Amazon has stuff as well. And Microsoft obviously has the Vision API as well. There are a couple of other things here as well. So there is also the speech API, and that basically is in two ways. So we have a text-to-speech service, and we have a speech-to-text service. And I will be talking about the last one, because that's the most interesting part. I mean, you all, maybe some of you have an Amazon Echo, it will talk to you. Maybe you have a Google Home device that will talk to you. Basically, in a nutshell, you can specify some text in your software and the computer will say it. But the other one is more interesting because then we have to, what we want to do is we want to talk to the computer and it should understand what we want. So that's part of the speech API. Then we also have the language API or the language service. And the language service is, maybe you've dealt with it already. If you're using Skype, for instance, Skype has the ability to real-time translate into a different language. So I happen to have a couple of Russian colleagues, and my Russian is, I guess, as most of you, on the same level, which is zero. But I was actually able to talk Dutch into my Skype headset. Skype would translate it into Russian. It was not entirely exact. And my colleague was able to talk Russian back to me, and that would be translated into Dutch. And so that is a very powerful feature as well. So it's able to to understand what you say, and it will translate it accordingly. Another service that comes with the cognitive services is knowledge. And that is based on a lot of information found on the web. It is also based on information found in databases in universities and stuff like that. So you can find all kinds of very detailed information in that. And slightly, I mean, it's close to the knowledge one, is the search API, which is obviously based on the Bing search engine that is from Microsoft. Well, we only have an hour, so I will deal with a couple of interesting services here, I will start off with the Vision API, and I will also go on with the speech, and then particularly the natural language understanding. So that means that I can give a command to the computer and we can act accordingly, right? So what can we do with it? Well, I did that already. I'm always a bit ahead of my slides, but let's talk a bit about the Vision API. That's what I'm going to start with. It can describe content of pictures and videos. What does it mean? You can upload a photo to the service on Azure. I mean, the whole cognitive services is running on Azure because you need a lot of computing power, storage, etc. You'll upload a photo and you'll get a description back in text. So it will tell you actually what's on that picture. And I'll give you a couple of demos in a minute, and you'll see it's pretty awesome. I mean, it can recognize quite a bunch of things here, and especially if you are into developing software that has to deal with a lot of images, like an insurance company, and you need to analyze, damage reports. You can actually have the Cognitive Services API process those images for you, and you can act if it's not entirely sure or if it's not entirely clear, then you can process it manually. But you'll see that it does a great job on that. You can also upload a video. I won't be doing that in this session because we're on Wi-Fi and I'm pretty sure that the video will fail to upload. But in a nutshell, you can upload a video and you'll get a description back on what's on the video. Besides the description, it can also recognize faces. And so it can actually create it can determine on which places are faces and if those faces are happy or not happy. And in most cases, it can also recognize the age of a person that was on the picture. And you can check that actually live in action. There is this stand right across the hall. They've got like a big mirror, and that is actually running on the Cognitive Services API. It will take a picture of you, and it will tell you how old you are. It doesn't always work. My colleague is about 60, I think, and he was getting a result of 80, so that was not like a compliment. I'm 45, and he said it was 44, so I kissed the mirror, so that was good. But it generally does a good job on that. And, well, it can also recognize, it can capture and recognize audio. This has to do with the speech API. This I told you already. I'm always a bit ahead of my slides, so let me sync up here. And this is for the next part. Let me first show you how that works with the Vision API. That is really, really a cool thing here. You can play around for hours with it, which I did. And first of all, if you want to get started with this stuff, you can go to azure.microsoft.com, and then if you search for the Cognitive Services, you'll get this homepage. You will obviously need to have an account on Azure, because it will need a couple of keys to have your data being processed. And once you have your account set up, you're ready to go. And what happens next, basically, is I've already logged on the dashboard. You can add a number of things here. So I have added a Cognitive Services Vision entry. And this is also what I'm going to use next. The thing with all these services is that you will get a couple of keys, security keys. Yeah, so they're here as well. And I will reset them after the session, so take pictures or whatever. I don't mind. Anyway, that key is going to be used in a small demo application that I created in Visual Studio. For simplicity, I used a web forms application with an upload control so I can upload images, but you can imagine it's not much of a difference if you want to do it with MVC or .NET Core or whatever. The thing that I'm doing here basically is in the code behind, that's why I did it in this way. I will upload the picture and I will send it over. I have this little routine here. I will actually get the bytes being uploaded and I will send it to the Vision client. The Vision client is something that that comes with the Vision API. It's a NuGet package that you can install and you can access it. So I'm also specifying a number of things here, what I want to have returned. And if I will run this demo, I will the demo has an upload box and it has like a results box. And obviously the results box is quite the thing that we want to see. Can everybody read it or should I make it a bit bigger? Bigger? Yeah. Okay. Better? Cool. All right, so I have prepared a number of images. Remember the beers and the coffee for everybody who didn't see it. The coffee didn't belong there. But I'll show you that this Vision API is actually able to tell me which picture isn't there. So let's first start with the dog and see what it does. So I'll select an image. I'll upload it and send it over to the Vision API. It's now being processed. And once it's finished, I get some results back in plain JSON. Well, we can all deal with JSON. Let us wait a second before everything is done. Obviously, I need some Wi-Fi, which tends to be a bit slow every now and then. But here are the results. And let me go over these results. This is about it. What we see here is an array with categories, more interesting, and a filled array with tags. And what we see with the tags is that it has assigned the tag grass to it. Here. It also has a confidence factor, and that is the thing that comes with all the cognitive services. All the results will have a confidence factor. And in this case, it is 99.99% sure, so it's absolutely pretty sure that there is grass involved. It is also quite sure, well, it's a bit of a strange dog with all the wrinkles and stuff, but it's still 99% sure that there is a dog involved as well, and that the dog is actually outdoors. That could be because of the grass, but then again, there are also buildings with grass inside. And then there are a whole bunch of other tags as well. So it isn't too sure about the tanning factor of my dog. That's actually my dog, and he loves the sun. He gets sunburns when he is too long in the sun, but he will not get a tan. But then again, it's only 12% sure. So if you need to deal with images, large amounts of images, you can actually have like a threshold in your own solver, like everything below 70% needs to be processed manually or something. So that's why they include the confidence factor. Then you'll get another list with the tags without the confidence factor. But the most interesting thing here is the caption, the description of this photo. It's a large brown dog laying on green grass. It is 78% sure of that. He is actually correct, because the dog in real size is about this. So it's not like a big dog or a large dog. It's an average dog. But again, he was pretty much right about the dog laying on the green grass. And so I'd say that's pretty clever. If we get back to the other dog, I had another dog. There are a couple of other things that might be interesting here. So it will also report whether it is adult content. I can tell you, I've tested it at home over a VPN. I didn't want anyone to know. I can assure you, it knows when it is adult and when it isn't. I'm not going to show it here. You have to trust me for that or test it yourself. Don't want to have anything to do with it. Or if it is racy content as well. So I didn't check that one. I thought the other one was more interesting. But I'm pretty confident that it will tell me whether it is racy or not. And then there are a couple of other things that might be interesting if you process images on a large scale, like the dominant foreground background colors. And the dimensions of the image. I do have to say that I have resized the image while I'm uploading it, because there's a certain limit. Yeah, if I would take a picture with my phone, it's like a really large image. So I'm resizing it to a certain maximum, because otherwise it's too big and you'll get an error in return. So, but Yeah, so that's basically how the Vision API works. And well, if I would upload one of the other dogs, for instance, this one, it's still a dog, but it looks slightly different from the other one. This is not my dog, by the way. Then you'll see that it will give you a different description, and well, the text will be pretty much the same. There was also grass involved, and I know it's going to show with a slight error in the description, but you'll see that in a minute. It's actually a pretty funny one. So once this one is uploaded, we'll get some different results back. One, two, three, off we go. And this also wasn't a big picture, so it should be processed fairly quickly. All right, so I'll talk a bit while it's uploading. Yeah, so what you see here is that it is pretty organized what you get back, and this is actually information that you can process in an automated system. And obviously, if you're dealing with a large amount of images, yeah, you can do this. And as I mentioned before, the other big platforms, I mean, Facebook is able to tell who is actually on the picture. If you have a Facebook account, it can find you anywhere. They decided to cancel that because that was a bit, it worked a bit too good, basically. Not everybody wants to be found, et cetera, et cetera. And with the whole GDPR stuff, they turned that feature off. But they are actually able to recognize anybody that has a Facebook account, which is probably most of us. Okay, so I have the impression that this is... it's already done. Yeah, it's already done. Yeah. Okay, so what we see here is, well, there is grass involved. There's a dog. It did notice that it is a dog as well. And a couple of other things here. The description is actually pretty funny because it says it is a black and brown dog carrying a frisbee in his mouth. Well, if you remember, I'll show the picture again. That was actually not a frisbee, but it was his tongue. So there are some funny, it's not 100% fail-safe, but it is getting better like every day. And obviously, Microsoft is training this service with everything that we probably upload and fine-tune the machine learning processes and the algorithms which come with it. And so this is a very interesting thing. Another thing, I mentioned it before, it can recognize faces. And it can not only recognize faces. Maybe some of you know this girl. It happens to be a Dutch famous photo model. I kind of spoiled it now by the name. But let me upload it anyway. So this girl's name is Doutzen Kroes. And she does modeling work all over the world. And what you'll see with the response is that the Vision API is actually able to recognize that this is Doutzen Kroes. And so celebrities are recognized as well. And it will also spoil us with the fact that they show her age. And so now we all know that this is Doutzen Kroes, that's correct. And somewhere here, they'll tell us that she's 28 years old. Well, that seems about right. Yeah, so that was pretty smart. And another interesting thing here is the face rectangle. So these are basically the dimensions or the positions on the photo where her face is. And this was actually a full portrait photo. And it's also what the caption says, Doutzen Kroes looking at the camera. Yeah, so we can also do that with our good all-time favorite, which one do you prefer, Mr. This man or the big guy? It will recognize it as well. And so this is what you can actually do with the Vision API. And I'd say it is a pretty powerful, and they train this thing like by the day, so it's getting smarter every day. And this will also enable us to distinct those pictures of the glasses of beer and the coffee, because it is actually able to see that it is a cup of coffee or it is a glass of beer. And so it's slightly, yeah, there we are. Here we are, Arnold Schwarzenegger wearing glasses. And he was still young then. I guess that's about true. It was Terminator 1, so it was not that old yet. So the last thing I'm going to show you here is obviously the coffee, because I asked you about an algorithm here. No need for it, because this thing can solve this problem for us. It will actually come back with a result something like a cup of coffee, if it hurries up a bit. And so this is a very powerful thing that you can actually already use in your own applications, and you can actually embed it in an existing application. Maybe you want to have like an extra feature, or maybe you want to extend it. You can actually use this pretty simple, because the only thing you need to do is submit the data to the service and you get this result back. And so the description of the cup of coffee here is actually a cup of coffee on the table. And so that is how good this stuff works, basically. All right, so one of the other things, so that's it about the Vision API. If you have any other questions, you can ask me later on. But I'd like to continue with one of the other interesting things that come with the cognitive services here. So let me head back to the slide deck, which is actually the thing that was in the title of this session, where we're going, we don't need keyboards. Well, if you don't want to use keyboards anymore, we should probably talk to the computer and it should act accordingly. And that brings us to a very interesting thing here, which is the natural language understanding. If I would give a voice command to the computer or to any device, you all know we can do that in 10 different ways. I could say, search the web for Arnold Schwarzenegger. But I could also say, Google me Arnold Schwarzenegger. And so there are like 10 different ways that we can actually ask something. We as humans, because of our cognitive features that we have, basically, we understand it. Yeah, but a computer, as you all know, that's a different story. So we need to be able to tell the computer, like, okay, this is probably what we ask, and we need to act on that. And if we, the way that that's being done is that machine learning models needs to be implemented, so we have a lot of data and we can draw the computer can draw conclusions out of it. And what we basically want is, if I talk to the computer and we get it back, and we need to get back into our software, we would want basically, as a result, a method that needs to be executed with a number of parameters that also come out of our natural command. Yeah, so I'm going to do a demo after this to search for a flight from Amsterdam to London. So what I would basically want to have in return, execute method book flight, departure Amsterdam, destination Oslo, or whatever I said. And so I need the method and the parameters, and then we can do something in our software with it. And for that, we need machine learning, so we can fine-tune that understanding, and we need to train that model. And, well, there were a couple of people here that have done something with machine learning. If you would take a look at this stuff, like, I guess a year ago, maybe 1.5 years ago, you actually had to get your hands really dirty in the machine learning stuff to set up a model, to do all kinds of stuff on the machine learning model. And I mean, I'm not a machine learning model expert, but that was something for me like, I'll wait until it's been made easier as it is right now. So they have made it way more easier to do this whole natural language understanding. And so how can we do that? We can do that with a tool which is called the Language Understanding Intelligence Service, also LUIS. And maybe you've heard of LUIS, maybe you don't. It's also a tool which is used for Skype bots. You can build a Skype bot where you can enter some commands and then the bot will act. It is based on the same tool. And I have already opened that up in my browser. Let me see where that is. If you would go to lewis.ai, my session has expired. Refresh the page. Let's do that. And you sign in with your Azure account because, again, it's based on the Azure infrastructure. So if you sign on with your Azure account, then you'll be able to set up to configure an application where you define what your application should understand and what it doesn't understand. Yeah, so more important, it doesn't need to understand everything, but you have a specific domain that you want to use for your application. Yeah, and as I mentioned, I will do a small travel app. So I'm going to create a new application here, and I'm giving it a name, Travel NDC Oslo. It is also important that you specify a culture. And I mean, half a year back, there were only like 3 items here. But you see that Microsoft is improving this quite a bit. So they even have Dutch now, which is pretty amazing to me. But I'll stick to English. And then you can give it a description as well. But that is not really important right now. So my travel application has been created, or my model, my machine learning model has been created now. And what we need to do is we need to tell this application what needs to be done. And so in this case, I'm going to create a new intent. So that is something that I want to be done. And in this case, I will give it a name, which I will call book flight. And in software, this is basically the method that we want to invoke once this command has been recognized. So once this intent has been created, it will ask me for a couple of examples. And this is all not voice related yet. We'll get that at the end of the session. So now I need to teach him what I want, basically. So I can enter an example here. Book me a flight from Amsterdam to London. And I'll hit enter. And it says type about 5. And the thing here is the more you give it, the more accurate it will be. But because of the time, I will just enter a few. And now what we need to do is we need to specify, we need to give this thing a couple of utterances. That's how they call it, which are basically the parameters that I want to have in return. So I say, book me a flight from Amsterdam, and this particular thing would be my departure. So I'll give this the name departure. It's going to be a simple type. You can actually use some other types as well, but I'll keep it simple now. And I will need to have the London one, and that will be my destination. It's also going to be a simple one. Yeah, but there is also another way that I can ask it. I could also say, I want to fly from Oslo to New York next week. And so this is the second example that I give this book flight intent that should also be triggered. And so if I now select this one, I can say this is my departure. And if I pick this, I can say this is my destination. And this is going to be an interesting one because this is actually, I want this to be returned as a date next week. That will be today plus 7. So I can say I can use a pre-built entity for this. And there is a list with pre-built entities. As you can see, a number, dimensions, a whole bunch of things here. I'm going to pick the daytime version 2 here. So now it knows that I specified a date basically here as well. Yeah, so I can enter another one, search, get me 2 adult business class tickets from Seattle to Madrid. Okay, so now I've introduced a couple of new things. And you can imagine that if I assign these ones as well, this is a destination, this will be the departure. I now have 2, because I want to have 2 tickets, so I can use a pre-built entity for that, which is going to be a number. And I can actually select, this will be the passenger type code. You could have other like infants and children and senior citizens, etc. I will call this PTC, passenger type code. And this would be the class. Well, I'm going to leave it with 3. That will be enough, probably. One of the other things that I'm going to do is I will create another intent. So while we fly to a certain destination, we might want to know the weather on our destination. Yeah, so I will go back to the intents, and I will create another one, which I will call get weather. Obviously, I will do this so we can actually see how it determines in the end what to pick. I will only put one thing in here. How is the weather in Oslo? And for this, we only have, I will take the destination for that. So what I've done now is I have created basically 2 methods that it should recognize. And if you have like a fairly big application, you can imagine that you have like a whole list of those intents, that you also have a lot of data that needs to be trained. So a lot of examples to build its experience. If you remember the first slide, experience, well, that's what we're building right now. And once we are done configuring whatever we want here, we need to train that model. And basically what's happening now in the background is that the machine learning model has been configured and it's now being fed with data and it is going to do all kinds of machine learning things that I don't know what's happening exactly, but it does some magic now. And we should now be able to test it. Yeah, so I can now actually ask a question and I can say, get me a flight to London. It is now actually gonna analyze my natural language command, and it came to the conclusion that it is going to be the book flight. It's 77% sure. And we can actually tell him that he was wrong or that he is right. So we can train him some more. And it will also collect the entities. In this case, it didn't recognize London. And that is probably because I didn't feed it enough with enough combinations that it could draw a conclusion out of that. So if I would specify how is the weather in Spain, is this still readable, by the way, or should I zoom in the browser? Okay. Let me zoom in anyway. So how is the weather in Spain? So if I would test that again, then I would get the get weather. It's not too sure. That is also because of the fact that I only trained it with like one natural language command, basically. But, I mean, it's to give you an impression. So once we have trained the model, we have tested it a bit, we can actually start using it in our own application. And to do so, we can go to the publish setting here, because now we need to publish this service. It was not public yet, so we need to publish this one. I'm just going to straight publish it to production. And what it's going to do now, it has set up a some sort of a web API backend. So there is a URL that I can request. And I can access that I can invoke the recognition, basically. Again, there is a key involved. I'm going to use this key. And I'm going to open this one in a new tab. Because now we are actually able to use this. In this case, it is there is nothing here. And that is because the queue, which is the query, has not been filled in. If I would now specify something, search for a flight from Oslo to Amsterdam today, I will get a result, and that is actually a very interesting result here. I'll zoom in a bit because it is fairly small. So let me make it a bit bigger here. So what it actually did is it returned the query that I asked. It is 81% sure. In this case, I call it a score, but it is actually the same as the vision, the confidence factor. It is 81% sure that you wanted to do the book flight. It is also only 15% sure that it was going to be the get weather. It could also be that it is something that it didn't recognize, and then it should return with the none. But it's almost sure that it wasn't the none. So if I would scroll a bit down, then there are some interesting things here as well. So the first step was that it determined that we need to invoke the book flight method. But then with the book flight method, we need a couple of parameters, because we need to know where to fly to and when. And well, what you see here is that it has found the entity today in my search query. It's giving me the positions as well in the original search query. And the interesting thing here is, because it was of this type date time v2, it does actually calculate, well, it determines that it is today, which is the 15th of June. If I would change the today in my query to next week, it will give me a different date. We can do something with this date, because this is like a structured value, and we can just pass that in our application, and we can process that. One of the other things here is that it also found a departure, and I'm pretty sure that I specified something else, or did I want to fly from? Yeah, it didn't find Amsterdam for some reason, so it didn't find the destination. Yeah, but I did find the departure. Well, the reason that it didn't find my destination is because I have fed this model with just three lines. And you can imagine that if there are like 1,000 examples in there, and you can actually feed this query into the machine learning model. So if your users request some information, you can actually feed it into the machine learning model, so your model will be expanded and it will get more accurate. So the more data is in there, the more accurate it will be. But it is, again, it is 88% sure that the departure is Oslo. If I would enter more into the web interface, then it will probably find Amsterdam as well. Maybe if I rephrase my my sentence, my query, so maybe if I would do book me a flight, it's good possible that I will find it as well, that it will find everything that I wanted. So if I would say, book me a flight from Oslo to Amsterdam today. Let's see where it comes back with. Book me a flight from Oslo to Amsterdam today. So let's scroll down. Nah, for some reason it's not going to find the destination right now. But yeah, so this is actually one of the things that you need to train this model so it will understand. And this is also the difficult thing with natural language understanding. I mean, you can rephrase it and it might understand it or it might not understand it at all. So this is why we need to give this model experience by feeding it data, basically. So one of the things that is obviously on the list as well is, can we do this in our own software? Yes, we can. And one of the other things that I'm going to show you is the speech API. So remember this Lewis thing. I'll get back to that in about a couple of minutes. I'm now going to discuss the third service that I wanted to show you, which is the speech service. And I am mostly interested in the speech-to-text service. How does that work? Well, I've set up another page. And by the way, you can download this project. It's on GitHub on my last slide. My GitHub account is there. You can download it and you can check it out yourself. There is this page here. Let me boot it up, which is the speech page. What we need here is obviously our Bing speech API key. And what I'll do now is this, I will paste my key in a sec. But what this page actually does is quite a bunch of JavaScript, because it will actually open a WebSocket to the API endpoint on Azure, and it will live stream everything that I tell the computer into the service. And then you'll see in a minute what the result will be. So let me quickly look up my key here by going to my Azure portal, and I have the key here somewhere, if it is opening up. Is it doing something or? Yeah, I still have Wi-Fi access. Well, let me refresh the page in this case because my session might have been expired here. So once we're back on, I can go to my portal for the speech API and I'll get my key here. I don't need you guys right now. I'm going to copy one of my keys and I'll head back to the speech. I'll paste the key in here. And again, it supports a number of languages to recognize. That's important because it needs to know it. There is a couple of recognition modes here, and I'm just going for the simple result. And the input will be the microphone on my notebook, so not this one. If I now hit the start button, I can actually tell something. So let me start it and tell something. Welcome at NDC London. Okay, the last thing was probably my mistake, but what you see here is that it actually recognized quite some stuff here. And this is the speech recognition part. So what this only does is it will recognize what you say, and you will get it back in JSON. And you'll get some information extra, like the duration, and maybe there was like a little pause up front. Yeah, so if I would change this and I would tell something else, book me a flight from Amsterdam to London, you will see that it has recognized it totally fine. So we can actually now chain up those services, and that's what we're going to do. I created this Lewis model So let me enable something here on the page, which I already put in. And what I will do is, once I have this result back, because the audio stream didn't go to the local web server, it went directly to Azure. So the results are being passed back on in the browser, and there was nothing on the server being done yet. So I will chain the result that I get from the speech API, and I will send that over to my natural language understanding service, and then that would result in something that allows us to speak to the computer and do something with it. So for that, I will remove a couple of things here. Like this. And if I now reload the page, let me see if the key was still in here. We'll have an extra little thing under this results from the speech service. And the idea now is that if I would paste in my key again, I hit start, I'll give the same kind of command that I did. I can now actually tell this application, book me a flight from Amsterdam to London next week. Now this result is being posted back to the Lewis application, so that was the natural language understanding. And what we'll see here is that it has found that I wanted to do the book flight. I didn't want to do the get weather. I specified next week, so it has changed the date here. Next week starts the 18th and it ends the 25th, so that was pretty clever. It also found Amsterdam to be the departure. London, for some reason it didn't recognize it now, is the destination. And so what I basically now did in a nutshell, I spoke to the computer without keyboards, and the results that we have in our Lewis response we can deal with, and we can actually process that in our application. And this has been set up in a way that you can actually extend your existing application with this kind of functionality and, yeah, give your end users an even better experience as they already had. Let me see if I needed to catch up with a couple of slides. I think that we did everything. Well, I did it with Visual Studio. There are a couple of URLs you might want to copy. So if you want to play around with Lewis, you can find it on lewis.ai. You need an account on Azure. And with this, I hope I've given you some inspiration on getting into artificial intelligence and speech recognition, etc. And make some really cool future-proof applications. If there are any questions, let me know. Otherwise, thank you. If you want to know more, after the session, I'll be at the booth of DevExpress, the big orange one. You can come by and ask me more about it.